Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Gabor Kiss, and today we will be talking about optimum currency areas. In this case, actually, when we are talking about optimum currency areas, we are talking about the Eurozone, since mostly when we are looking on the map, we can find mainly the Eurozone, which fits to the requirement of currency unions, and also the optimum currency area. Because, okay, there are other currency unions, you can say me, because in Africa there is the Western African Currency Union, also there is the Central African Currency Union, so we can see example elsewhere, but still, at least we can say the closest thing that we can find which meets the requirements of optimum currency area should be looked around the Eurozone. So, first of all, if a geographical region would like to introduce a single currency, which maximizes the efficiency in the area, then they should meet the currency area requirements. So, what are these requirements? Actually, these requirements were defined by Mundell many years ago, so if we are scrolling down to the sources, we can see that, yeah, it was in the 60s. And since then, it was criticized many different ways. In Hungary, for example, if you are looking for Esther Boros, she has made recent high-quality publications in this topic. So we can find some refinement, but actually the requirements are highly similar. So we can say that, okay, they mingled something with it. I can say that there was some sort of revolutionary turnover here, just major refinements. So first of all, labor mobility across the region. So obviously, if you are looking on the European Union, since the existence of the European Union, we can see that the free movement of capital, free movement of people, and free movement of goods and services, so trade, was allowed. So this is mainly the difference between the previous versions of the European integration, because the European Union defined these four freedoms. Why it's good to move from one part to another? Actually, the benefit can be that in this case, people who are operating or working and living in the less performing regions, so in the periphery, they can go to the center. Why? Because in all integrations, doesn't matter that which economy we are looking there, there will be always a core and the periphery. If there is no core, then it's a problem, because it means that the country is in complete trouble, but if you are looking on a country, if you are looking on a city, if you are looking on the European Union, there will be always core regions where the productivity growth is the fastest, the highest, then we can find corporate headquarters, where the research and development blooms, so we can find their core territories, and also unemployment is really low because they need manpower. This is not the case for the periphery, what we have to meet here as well. So mostly periphery regions have usually higher unemployment or lower employment ratios, and also the economic output is lower there, the productivity is lower. So even if some things are outsourced there from the center, because usually peripheries has also lower wages because of lower productivity, still we can say that the added value will be lower. So that's why if you are allowing labor mobility across the region, then you can avoid many frictions. You can reduce the level of frictions, even if you are looking on the US. So in many cases, the Eurozone is blamed, or European Union is blamed for many things, but actually, if we are looking on the United States, we can find their similarities. Just what is the difference? Obviously, we can say that, yeah, the US has a federal level budget, which redistributes 20% of the GDP. And we can find the same thing, obviously, in the Eurozone, because there is only 1% now. Due to COVID, it's 2% still. So labor mobility is crucial, because it allows people to compensate regional differences. But in this case, labor mobility will also create or requires further integration, because you have to accept education levels, you have to accept, you have to provide at least public services like healthcare, like unemployment benefits, other social benefits to the people who are working there, regardless they are not citizen, but citizen of the European Union. So that's why it has many spillovers to other politics. Openness with capital mobility, price and wage flexibility across the region. The first part is highly obvious. So if you are not allowing the free movement of capital, then why to do this? But in the ordinary corporate sector, nothing new here, because yes, we can find there companies and then parent companies and multinational or transnational companies, it doesn't matter. The problem is that if you are allowing this in the banking sector, then it will require further safety measurements, because you know that banking sector is special, because actually they are absolutely depend on economics of scale. So if since they are lending out clients or depositors money, or maybe they are issuing bonds on the market and they are collecting, this doesn't matter how they are combining, but so they are collecting some sort of liabilities from client and they are lending this out. So the entire profitability will depend on the margin between asset and liability side. The interest rates, how they are different from each other, and after that they can define the profit. And of course, banks are not just special because of this endeavor, but also they are highly dangerous because they are accumulating the savings in the entire economy, or sometimes even for abroad. And it means that if they are lending this in the wrong way, so they are not prudent or not solvent, so they are not able to retrieve the money from the debtors, then they are facing the troubles. So they can burn away the depositors' money. Obviously, we have depositors' insurance against that. But still, the problem is that in the case of crisis situations, you have to bail out the banks, not because it's nice thing, but if you are not bailing out the banks, then it will have a widespread effect. So first of all, people are not able to take out their deposits, so corporate sector and also households will not able to use their money stored in the banking system or in the bank. It's a systemic, or it can be a bank crisis, individual crisis, and also we can say that and at the same time, your banks are not able to provide loans as well, so further investments will be also stopped. So that's why you have to be really strict in macro and micro level of the prudential policies. Later on, we were talking about this, because it was absolutely not managed by the European Union and the Eurozone at the beginning, and the first decade of the Eurozone, and then during the 2010s they had to realize that they need this. So right now they are building up this thing which is called as the Banking Union. Unfortunately, the speed is declining, because now politicians start to forget why it's necessary, but later on, during later chapters and sessions, we will talk about this. So capital mobility is not that easy. Wage flexibility is also a romantic issue, because in many cases we can say that wages are not flexible. So since Keynesian economics, we can say that wages are flexible upwards. But cutting down wages, you have to be in a really, really deep recession to let this happen. Okay, there are rumors that... data that, for example, in Spain, the crisis was so deep that people were able to see wage cuts, but this is the last resort, so you don't want this. Production diversification. This is also important because if you have monocultures in your exports or in forming your GDP, that can be a problem. Just it's not just that, okay, I'm an oil exporter. This would be the simplest way. But if everybody works in automotive sector and some shock appears in the automotive sector, this will have the same result. Or if your GDP growth depends highly on real estate developments, like it happened in the Mediterranean in the 2000s, then it can be also a problem, because if you are running out lending, so if the lending is declining because there is an overcapacity now in the market, then it will also freeze down the entire economy. So production diversification, it means that sectors should be combined together, because otherwise it doesn't matter if it's real estate, it doesn't matter if it's automotive or agriculture or extractive sectors, and still the problem can be the same. Similar business cycles. Otherwise it will be really hard to make any kind of harmonized monetary policy, so it's necessary for the monetary policy. And in this case we have to say that, okay, but it's never mentioned here, but obviously if you have a common currency within this optimum currency area, it means that you will have one single sole central bank which monopolizes the monetary policy. So after that, there is always a trade-off that, okay, my individual needs as a member state of this currency union will be just partially paid attention, or they are focusing only partially on this, because now they have to manage the entire currency union. And I think that you can feel that, okay, but in this case it can affect peripheries worst, because if overheating can happen way easier in the core territories because they have higher, bigger growth potential. Also, investments are flowing there. So, or even if there is a bubble bursted in the peripheral territories, then still the central bank should focus on the entire region. So it will be hard. Actually, similarities in business cycles, they are not great problems, because they are happening. So if you are allowing the free movement of capital and there are transnational companies everywhere, then the similarity happens. So since the 80s, we can say that globally business cycles are the same. The problem is that the magnitude. So if we are looking on the German economy, yes, they fall down into recession in 2008. But after that, the recovery time was several years. So within 1 or 2 years, they were growing again. So they recovered fast. Unfortunately, in the peripheral regions, like Spain or Italy or Portugal, this recovery was taking 4 or 5 years. Or in Greece it was way longer, so it's 2018 once they started to recover. So actually the problem is that once you start a recovery, you start to be really happy. Just usually business cycles are keeping for 8 years, maximum 10 years. And so once you start to recover, then it can happen that, okay, but globally the business cycle ends and there is a new recession. So you're not able to grow because you just recover from the previous shock. So it can be a problem. That's why we have fiscal policy to balance these things out, not just monetary policy. So that's why fiscal money is necessary to redistribute it among the different areas. And we can say that we can find the regional differences also in the US. So if you are looking on California, which is enormous, so alone it would be fifth biggest economy or something like this, so it's huge. But also at the same time we can find there some corn states where the economic activity is lower because of their different focus. So that's why fiscal transfer is necessary. Yeah, paying taxes it's hard, and we know that people. So billionaires and multinational companies are using tax havens to optimize their taxation, but You have to do something with this, because otherwise your optimum currency area will fall to pieces sooner or later because of political issues. So the similar preferences, ideologies, they are necessary because otherwise politicians are not able to sit next to each other at the table. And solidarity is not just because if someone cries, then you have to tap their shoulders. Actually, it means that if you need safety measurements. So if there is a crisis, you have to have a fund to deal with this. And it was also not the case, not real in the case of the Eurozone before 2010. After that, after some ad hoc period of crisis management, they created the European Stability Mechanism, which extends the power of the International Monetary Fund and is designed only for the Eurozone. So the solidarity is highly financial. So in the case of the European Union, we can say that the different parts are related to different subsections, and I talked about them. So let's move forward, because what is the key motivation here? The key motivation here is that countries are doing or conducting their trade with each other, and this first graph talks about that export of goods and services to GDP ratio. So how export or foreign trade contributes to the GDP. And we can see that many countries in Central Europe, they are highly related to their foreign trade. Okay, there are relatively closed economies as well, but still we can say that for Central Europe, obviously, they will relate it to each other. And if we are looking on the share of trade within the EU 2020, so how much percentage of one member state's export and import is going or coming from the European Union, we can say that it's always above 60%. Okay, we can find here Cyprus, but Cyprus is here in the middle of the sea, so but still their export is relevant, or their European Union is their main export market. Even if we are looking on Brexit Island, still we can say that half of their export and import is related to the European Union. So why not mess it up with customs and tolls and quotas and so on when you are stepping out from the Union? And also we can say the Central European effect here. So Austria, Germany, Czechia, Denmark, Netherlands, So for some reasons the Eurostat uses this kind of ordering. So we can see that mainly they are trading with each other. So in this case, when you are using Euro, actually you are eliminating the exchange rate risk from the trade. So this is the first benefit. And also we can say that the European Union is a significant player on global trade. So actually we can see that they have a major share from the cake, because 16% from the global export, 15% from global import was their share in 2017. So okay, in China or in the US we can find different numbers, but still it's a big one, and also it's an active one. So actually they have a surplus in trade balance. The Eurozone has actually bigger surplus. There were several years ago, I know that it was higher than China. So it's a big one. And of course globalization affected the Eurozone as well. So transnational companies started to step in to the so-called new member states. So even before the Baltics and Poland and Czechia, Slovakia and Hungary, and later on Romania, Bulgaria, Slovenia was joining with us, but Croatia was joining later. So even before we joined the European Union, actually foreign trade investors were flowing in from Central Europe and Western Europe to relocate facilities where the added value was lower, and that's why they were able to increase their profit margin because of the lower wages in this region. And since then, actually, there was the result was a really high or really strong integration in the level of trade, and also the banking sector followed this. So banks were also purchasing consolidated banks in the middle of the or after the middle of the 1990s because they wanted to follow their clients, and also they were able to find here nice growth opportunities. Okay, so let's see that how can we model this. So gravity models are actually used to describe this asymmetric situation. So we could say that, yeah, if a country is small, so let's say Hungary or Czechia, so we have 10 million people, or Slovakia, which is way smaller, or Slovenia, which is a cute one. So we could say intuitively that if you are a small economy, then you will be more integrated to the European Union. Or if you are big enough, then you are not so integrated because you are working much more on the global market instead of the club. So let's check this intuition. Actually, in this case, in gravity models, you are checking something like this. So there is always this gravity means that you are taking the difference between the local GDP and the GDP of the EU, so the gravitational center. It defines actually your size. And also after that we can add different variables, so share from the total export and then we have to add dummy variables to represent EU membership, are they part of the Eurozone, are they affected by recession from the Eurozone, and then we can build the simple model. And the epsilon is countries, this percentage. So actually the epsilon variable is this one. And then we will see that what happens here. And because it contains many different countries, it will be a panel data. So in this case, we are looking for some general applications, general phenomenon, which happens in all the countries. So no country-specific issues will be resulted at the end. And in this case, we are using dynamic panel regression, because if you are looking on the data, we can see here that I added all the member states, even the UK is here, between 2002 and 2018, because that was the biggest size of the European Union. But the problem is that this is a really small data set. So usually for a regression to make or to let it be operational, you need 30-20 data points. So the time interval should be big enough. So if you are under this, then for panel data, I recommend the usage of dynamic panel. And let's see the data set as well. So if you have panel data, then actually we need a country identification. So it's one for country one, two for country two, and so on. So they are stacked on each other, on top of each other, like gyros meat or pancakes or biscuits. And also we need time identifier, so we can see that they are the years, and after that we have the share, export differential, GDP differential, and I was also taking the logarithm of everything because we need common or similar scales, and logarithm can be helped in that. Recession was taken also from the side of the European Commission, Eurozone, and EU membership was taken from Wikipedia, because why not? Yeah, and the rest of the data was coming from the Eurostat. So let's see model panel, dynamic panel model. And logarithm. First let's see alone. Okay, dummy variables are added, set as default. Oh, we don't want to have any further things. Yeah. So first problem, that if we have a dynamic panel, then we have only one, or sorry, two diagnostics. One is the argon test, and actually it says that if it should be above 0.05, so otherwise the variable set is not good enough. And also at the same time, the first level autocorrelation should be significant, and the second should be not. And it works, just this one is not. So regardless that they are nice and significant, but we can't use this. Let's see that what is happening when we are increasing leg numbers. Well, not for the dummy. Still, Zargon says nope. Okay, so if we are looking on the final model, we can see that how I was able to solve this. There was one solution. I needed to add the export as well, because otherwise Zargon was not working. So let's try first a two-step solution. Now Zargon is actually working well. It's remarkable. Okay. But if we are continuing with the original setup, export differential and the dummies. Legs not defined. Then we can see that it is also a nice way to make this operational, because now Zargon test is it's two step. Sorry, folks. Oh no way. I used also the differentials. Yeah, makes everything clearer. Now, why should we use the differentials? Actually, because it makes everything easier from statistical point of view. Yeah, add differences. Because in this case, you are talking about the change, the increase, decrease, and that's why. It's more elegant. GDP export this. Dummies. Oh, come on. Yeah, I used previews. Okay, then let's use the two-step. Now it's working. And let's take out this export variable. So Actually, if we are using this, so what is happening here? And even if we are saying that we would like to use the old school model, so so we are staying at level. GDP diff, dummies to represent shocks. So we can say that the GDP differential, so in this case it means that we have numbers, and this number will be bigger and bigger if the country is smaller and smaller, because we are taking out, so it's a differential, and that's why. If it would be the country's member state GDP would increase, then it would create smaller number. So it means that if this GDP differential is negative, then it is good. So it supports our idea, and even if is growing, then it's still significant. Unfortunately, here when we are adding this export, then it will be negative, so it just messes things up and has no added value. And what is interesting here, because intuitively I would like to say that member state, so if someone is part of the Eurozone, they are more integrated, but we can't see it here, we can't see it here. Recession and membership of the European Union matters, but not even here. So what happened in the original setup? Yeah, not even here. So it's funny. Okay, so that was all about the optimum currency area, and next time we will talking about financial history. Bye bye.